real problem with this room and this tool is that the lights are up there, and I'm looking down on a blade and a line, and I can't see anything. So I really want to have the light here, a window or a light or some kind of a light source coming over my left shoulder if I'm right-handed, and that would illuminate the blade perfectly, and I'd see what I'm doing. Also, I wear a optimizer, and I use a number 4 lens, which gives me double power at 10 inches. And so the distance here is about 10 inches. I can see double size, and it really helps a lot to see what you're doing when you're cutting. If I'm in the middle of a cut, and I turn this without moving this, because the blade is rectangular, the blade is taller than it is wide. And the minute you rotate the pack, you twist the blade and lock it. So it's like shifting a bicycle without moving the chain. If you shift the bike and you're not moving your feet, it gums up the gears. So with this, what you have to do, every time that you're doing this, this has to move. So you keep that moving, and then you stop doing this and do this, you're in trouble. And if the phone rings and you walk away from it and it does that, it'll twist the blade. So if the phone rings and you have to get up, you have to get to a point where it's going to hang, and then you can walk away from it without twisting the blade. And it takes a bit, the first few days, for the students to get over that, because when the blade is twisted, instead of cutting down, it'll start cutting this way or this way, and you can't stay on the line. And you can't save the blade. You just throw it away and start over. Blades are disposable. We don't worry about breaking blades. It's one of those things that happens. The teeth either wear out and the blade is useless, or the blade is twisted, or the blade just breaks. I'll just rest my feet on the saw vise, and I'll just start cutting. And see, that's about 180 strokes per minute, which is what my overhead saw is set at. So if I come to a corner where I want to make a corner, if I lift up on the saw, it's not cutting at all because the back of the saw has no teeth. See, I'm moving it, but nothing's cutting because I'm up on the back of the saw. When I get to the point where I want to cut, I let the saw weight start to go, and I can actually cut it. That gives you those really sharp inside cuts because you can rotate around the radius of the blade, which is about 8 to 1/2 of an inch. So when I get to the end of the cutting, I can use the vise to clamp right up next to the blade and hold everything from breaking, and I can finish the cut. And then I have this plug of pieces. Which includes multiple cuts of everything. So you see how easy and quick it is to cut out lots of pieces. All the same, I have here the thicker back material. That's a waster board because that's my scrap wood at the back of the packet to keep the blade from tearing out the veneer. I have a layer of grease paper, which is lubrication for the blade. And then I have a dozen or so pictures of the leaf that all are cut out, you know, the way I want them. And,
this is a different type of saw. It's called a kataba. A kataba is nothing more than a single-sided Japanese saw that doesn't have a back on it. And katabas are scaled about the same scale as a real wood. So if you want to know the difference between this and this, chop off one side of the teeth to get one of these things. Interestingly, kataba tend to be priced about the same as a real wood, so this one is quite a bargain because it two saws for the price of one. But there are reasons why you want running katabas. For example, if you're making a very, very long cut in a board, it doesn't take much insight to see pretty quickly that as you're cutting through the board, the backside of the teeth might interfere with the cut as you go on. And there are two ways that you can get around this. One, which is what I actually usually do, is if it's binding or something on the backside and interfering with the quality of the cut, I'll just stick a wedge in top of the kerf open a little bit, and that usually takes care of that. Or you can get a katabas and then you don't have to worry about the issue at all. This is a Mabiki. This is a saw that Japanese saw makers use to help mill down logs. So this is the sort of thing that you'd want to use if you have any log you're going to cut into slabs. Notice that the top part here has slightly angled edge to it. That's not just to make the thing look nice and pretty. There's actually a practical use for this, because if you have two people, each with working on a log at the same time, one guy can saw and then pull back, and then the other guy saw can come and slide right by this flat edge and then pull back. And so you can have two guys sawing at the same time, each with their own saw. The teeth on this, despite their aggressive nature, nothing more than rip teeth that you would see on the rip side of a real bit of or Western rip saw, for that matter. And then recently, I've been going nuts on eBay and finding big saws that people are selling for some reason. This is a crosscut saw. It came without a handle. I still have to make a handle for it. But these are crosscut teeth. And again, this is really used for cutting down logs. But have you guys ever seen those long timber crosscut saws that are two-man? And if you remember, there's probably got these little notches in between. Okay, the Japanese came up with the exact same tooth geometry for what they wanted to do. Now, granted, this is a one-man saw as opposed to a two-man saw. But to me, it's interesting that in terms of designing saw teeth to accomplish a particular job, they're coming to the same conclusions that Western saw makers did back in the day. And I don't want to turn this talk into a big Japanese saws are so superior to Western saws that everyone should run out and get them, because that's not what I'm here for. Really, what I'm here for is to try to explain the use of these tools in such a way that if you primarily use even Western woodworking tools, you'll be better at them. Because, quite frankly, I've learned a lot about Japanese tools from listening to people talk about Western hand tools, and I think just overall that makes me a better woodworker. But anyway, if you cut on the pull stroke, what happens? If you have a piece of wood like so, and you're trying to cut the wood, the teeth engage the wood, and you're pulling back on it, which puts tension on the blade. And because you put tension on the blade, you don't have to worry about keeping the saw straight anymore, because the actual force of cut will straighten out the saw for you, and it'll allow you to cut on a straight line. Because you don't have to rely on the blade itself to keep itself straight, you can actually make the saw much thinner than you would a Western saw. Western saws that are set up for a particular task. So let's take a tenon saw that maybe Lee Nielsen or Lee Valley are selling. This is the sort of saw I would use to cut tenons with as well. The saw plate on this one is thinner. It's going to be thinner than the tenon saws that you would see. Why? Because if you're cutting on the push stroke, then the saw actually has to support itself as you make the cut. And because of that, there's a chance of it buckling if you are a little bit off track or something. Yeah, so the saw plate is made thicker to help support the saw as you do that. So why would you care if you have a thinner curve? Well, having a thinner curve means that you can remove less wood to accomplish the goal that you want. If you remove less wood, then it takes less force to make the cut. And that's really where the pull stroke comes into play. There are a couple other things that the pull stroke allows you to do. Work holding a bit less of a challenge, because since I'm going to make a cross cut on this piece of wood, and as I make a cross cut, the saw is going to catch onto the wood and pull it down, and the wood is sitting on the workbench, and the workbench is sitting on the floor. The floor isn't going anywhere, as far as I know. This building wasn't built to cover or something like that. But what that means is that as I make a cut, As I pull and when the saw advances its way through the wood, I'm actually clamping the wood to the table. I've got my hand over here to hold the piece of wood in place. I'm barely putting any force on this thing. And the wood is nice and stable as I make my cut. So when you make a cut with the Japanese saw, a lot of work holding issues are taken care of for you by the fact that you can cut on the pull stroke. At home in my workbench, I do most of my cutting, you know, cross cutting off the end of it, like so. And all you have to do is just put the piece of wood, you know, wood down and don't bother, you know, clamping it. And it makes manipulating work pieces a lot easier.